Today's video is all about playing around with and getting familiar with India ink. India ink is great to work with because it's like painting, but you can also draw with it, and there's nothing like that stark black that India ink can create. I will show you how to create a value scale using Bristol paper, a variety of paintbrush, and some non-conventional tools to get fine lines. If you love learning about art, hit that subscribe button so you never miss a weekly tutorial. Today I'll be using Blick Black Cat Waterproof India Ink. My school uses purchase orders through Blick Art Materials, so most of my supplies come through there because I'm using it in large quantities. I'll put some of my favorite other inks in the description box as well. Fill one well of your paint palette tray with your India ink carefully. Once you get it on your hands, as you can see, it takes a lot of effort to come out. I am marking with a little piece of tape that this is my pure India ink because you're gonna see the water cup here. I'll be watering down the ink to create different levels of gray, and I also wanna make sure I know which container is pure black. I'll be using a variety of different paint brushes, some non-conventional materials to create straight lines, and also a nib pen that is going to be more of a traditional, like, calligraphy fine line type of material. I am using smooth Bristol board to create my value scale because I love the white and I also like that it's really smooth. You can definitely practice doing this in your sketchbook, but I like to do it on the same type of paper I'll be using. So I cut small pieces for my students to practice on the paper they'll be using for their final product. A value scale is a series of dark to light values progressively going from one direction to the other. With India ink, I always like to start with black. So the first paint area is going to be pure black India ink. Make sure you don't have water on your brush because the water will dilute the India ink. And I'm just gonna paint a square overlapping, and you can see that the Bristol really does a great job of keeping the paint, or the ink, I should say, contained and not spreading out. So this is going to be our first section, which is black. Then I'm gonna take my brush and I'm gonna, in the next well, add a little bit of water and test it. That's still pretty dark, so I'm gonna dip my brush in my paint, water it down just a little bit more, and test again. That looks like a very nice dark gray. You'll notice I didn't touch the values yet. I will, but I don't want them to blend together. Making a nice square, checking my work, overlapping a couple times, and then I'm kind of being shy with touching, there we go. Perfect, it dried and it didn't blend together. So then I'm gonna take a scoop of that dark gray and I'm moving to the next paint well, adding a little bit here. Then I'm gonna dip my brush in the water, swirl it around a little bit, see if that is a more medium to dark gray. Looks pretty good. So I'm going to then go ahead and fill. And I wanna make sure that each of my sections kind of are the same size and shape. I did add a little bit of water to my brush, and you can see I'm just carefully and slowly connecting. Now these two values are pretty similar. It does get progressively lighter, and I'm gonna focus on doing a 5 or 7 step value scale. We'll kind of see where I end up. You could do as many values as you could create. You could do like a 20 step value scale. So then the same steps are repeated. I'm taking a little bit of that ink that I created, that more medium to medium dark gray, adding a little bit of water, testing it, and that actually looks pretty good. Then I'm gonna make my square, not touching the edges yet, giving it a little bit of a chance to dry, making sure it's the same size and shape. And that's a pretty, I would say that's getting more towards, oh, you can see it's bleeding a little bit. That's probably more light to medium gray. Then repeating my steps, I'm adding water in the well because I have so much ink on my brush that I feel like a little bit of water is all I need. Pretty similar here. Let's see how they look when it dries a little bit. So it is lighter. I don't know if it's exactly the next step. And that's the thing with a value scale. You can kind of do it over and over again until you really understand how to create those lighter values. That's the beauty of India ink, is it just is such a beautiful, rich grayscale. And I'm repeating my steps for my last value here, and I want this to be my lightest gray. So the goal with this one is that the next step would be pure white. I am gonna go back to that second value and do one more overlap because I feel like it's, my value scale is a little on the light side. So I just revisited that well right next to the black India ink to make it just a little bit darker by overlapping one time. So not a perfect value scale, but definitely getting the hang of creating dark to light values with my India ink. Now that I feel comfortable with my value scale, I'm gonna play around with line variety. And using a paintbrush, my line variety is gonna focus on thick to thin lines, and I'm gonna kind of dip in each of the little values that I created. So I'm progressing from my thickest line to thin, also kind of going from dark to light just to see what that looks like. I am just using a random round brush that I found in my classroom. You could play around with different types of brushes. Sumi ink brushes are really thick. You could get really fine point. You could even try a flat brush if you want to see what that would look like with your ink. So you can see with one brush, there's quite a lot of line variety that can be created. And I do have some smaller brushes to play with too. So I'm going to grab one of these. Then instead of focusing on straight lines that go from thick to thin, I'm gonna see what I can do with a smaller brush and see if I can create thin to thick with this smaller fine point brush. So as you can see, two different brushes, a lot of variety can be created here depending on how hard you press it down and how focused you get that kind of like fine line at the end. For this one, I kind of just use straight up black, and I'm practicing some hatch marks here. So just small lines that repeat next to each other. This is really nice, it's fun. And I know I can create a finer line when I get out my nib, my calligraphy pen, which we'll do at the end of the video. So here's just some examples of different line variety, playing around with the different textures. I'm also playing around with the different values that I created. And I'm trying my hand at some cross hatching. So hatching are the small lines next to each other, and cross hatching is when you cross over them. That's a great, really fun, satisfying way to create value when using ink. I'm gonna play with some wash techniques, and washes are large areas of paint, or in this case ink, that are broad, diluted with water, and cover kind of a large surface evenly. Now I'm doing a wet on wet technique where I did my gray wash and then I dipped a darker value into it, and you can see that really nice wet on wet bleed of ink that just creates really unpredictable, beautiful areas of light, beautiful areas of dark, just really fun to kind of watch happen. Confuse my words there. So washes are really, when you're doing large areas, washes are really important. Let's kind of focus now on some more smaller details. I'm gonna try out some unconventional materials before I get out my ink nib. And this is one of these little cherry cocktail toothpicks. And I'm dipping that in my ink. You can see it's really kind of dry and scratchy, so you have to dip in it a few times before you can get a mark. So if you're wondering, like, why in the world would you use this? If you don't have access to an ink nib pen, and you can see, look how fine the lines are. I actually like how gray it is, and you can overlap to create darker areas. So you can see the cross hatching is really satisfying here. And again, this is a non-traditional material, but as the ink really soaks into the end of the toothpick, you can see that it is getting darker. So this is just an option. You can see some fine lines here. If you don't have access to these materials, or you teach classes of 39 like me, and you're just looking for an easy solution if you don't have the materials on hand, this worked for me. Yeah, you'd probably have to throw it out. I'm doing some stippling here, some small dots. It wouldn't last forever, but I just thought it was a fun technique to try. A similar tool that I have a million of lying around my classroom are these bamboo shish kebab skewers. I use them with working with clay all the time. So I thought, well, I have a million of these. How does that work? And I would say it's very similar to the toothpick I used earlier. One of the benefits is I do think it has a longer, finer point, and it also is easier to hold in the hand because it's so long. The toothpick is kind of awkward because you have to kind of like manipulate your hand, whereas this fits in it almost like a pen or a pencil. I'm almost out of space, so before I get out my ink nibs, I'm gonna use my large brush again. I'm gonna create an area of a wash with lots of water, and then I'm gonna take a paper towel, and I'm gonna pull the extra ink to create a textured area and to create some variety of lights and darks. I know I'm gonna be creating an ink landscape, so this is great for creating texture like clouds. And if you accidentally, say when you're making your value scale, apply too much water or ink, you can pull the water, pull the ink, and you can see once your ink dries, you can go over it. It's water soluble, but when it dries, it sets. So this is a fun technique to create texture depending on what your work of art is going to be. Finally, let's get out those ink nibs. I don't currently have a class set of these, but if you do, you'll know that you can change out the different levels of ink. Here's my fail. You have to dip the ink, or you have to dip the nib in the ink so that it fills it all the way. So you wanna fill your container of ink all the way up so you don't have to kind of awkwardly turn it to the side like I'm doing. So you'll see it's a little awkward at first. I'm trying to write nibs in ink with some fails. Just watch me struggle, you can see there. And so a solution would be to make sure you have enough ink in your paint well so that you just dip it in once and you don't have this problem. There we go, finally, and you can see what wonderful controlled lines that you can create. And anytime you run out of ink, just dip it in there and get some more that will stay in the ink well. I am using the same size nib in this tutorial, but you can play around with the different sizes. It is possible to create a different width of line and line variety with a single nib. So it just depends on what materials that you have. I love doing hatching and cross hatching with these. It's just such a fine line. And I know my students are really interested in animation and inking. I know that inking drawings is a really big deal. And so India ink is just a really fun technique to experiment with. And it applies to a lot of real world jobs as well. I'm using some of that extra water from my washes because it hasn't dried yet. And you can see how the ink is bleeding out a little bit. Because it has more water than ink. So make sure you're dipping in your pure India ink, unless you like the gray kind of faded out line. So I'm gonna try to write, look how thick that line is. I'm gonna try and write out the word nibs again. Really, I'm only using one, so it should be nib, but you know. And I'm really just having fun playing around, scratching on my paper, playing around with different types of lines. It looks like a scribbly mess because it's just practice. It is a scribbly mess. And so I encourage when learning a new material, just kind of play around with the different things you can use, find what makes sense to you. And thank you so much for sticking around and making art with me. And if you're interested in more tutorials, check these out. Also, if you want to know what my students are currently creating in my classroom, find me on Instagram at thatartteacher_Machado.